Well, I guess when I imagine what this taking it all apart would be, is you'd say, okay, this is a weekend on alchemy, and at the end of it, by Sunday afternoon, as you all leave, you will each leave with your portion of the philosopher's stone, which you may eat as you go out the door, or shower under when you get home, or spread out like a large frisbee and sit on, and it will fly you home. Or, in other words, you will be given a piece of this translinguistic matter which obeys the laws of imagination and signifies that we have passed the transition point, that we're now living in the year zero plus 15 minutes. And because the new ontological thing has now entered the world. So it isn't really like a collapse of the state vector. It's like the emergence into it of the transcendent object, which we all sense. It's just that we can't quite see it yet, and we're always looking for it. It's either in the mountains, or in the future, or in the dream, or it's somewhere. We sense it. But finally, you know, you just confront it if you're very, very lucky. That's sort of what I think of the flying saucer as. The flying saucer is... you finally confront it. The spiritual object emerges. That's why I used to say, if you've seen the flying saucer, you're saved. In my brand of Pentecostalism, this is the kiss. If you've seen the saucer, it means you'll see it again when you die. It means, because what it is essentially is it's a vehicle waiting for you. And if you die and you don't have one, big trouble. So seeing the saucer in life means, you know, that it's okay. It's the anxiety about that can fade. And it's interesting how many higher religions have the metaphor of the vehicle. Buddhism talks about the triple vehicle, and shamanism talks about the drum as the vehicle, and soul flight is flight as a vehicle. You know, Justin, the patristic father, thought that the resurrection body would be spherical. I mean, he taught this, and it was just, you know, heathen controversialists just heaped scorn on it, and his notion spread alarm among all of those people who agreed with him, because it seemed so insupportable and crazy that the resurrection body would be spherical. He felt it had to be spherical because that was a perfect form. But it's interesting how, I mean, Jung has discussed how these round, the rotundum, the rota, the spinning thing, the spark, the scintilla. In fact, it's sort of hard to find, but I guess it's in the collected works. In 1948, Jung wrote a very interesting book called Flying Saucers, A Modern Myth of Things Seen in the Sky. And... really thinking about flying saucers has not advanced much past that. He correctly recognized it, I think, for what it was. Very few people have been to the moon, and a surprising number of them have come back touched in some strange way. And I think that it's simply, maybe it's the image. Maybe it's something as simple as that, that to see the entire Earth at one time actually changes you, that you can't come back for it, that it's on a very deep level, you know, that it's, you finally get the message. I think that it's a psychedelic environment, you know. It's like mind, and this is what I always say about space. You see, the problem is that we are obsessed by the imagination. And throughout history, we've been obsessed by it, and our obsession with it has caused historical time to come into being. And we've learned more and more about energy to the point now where the imagination has actually become a lethal force directed toward ourselves as a species and toward the entire ecosystem of the planet. Our musings have led us, you know, to the hydrogen bomb and all of these things. So we have become an anti-terrestrial force. If we do not leave, we'll blow up the joint. We have become a bull in a china shop. And yet what it is that we want to do is, we're like coral animals. what coral animals do is they gather calcium from the sea, free atoms of calcium, which they then fabricate into their architectonic structures, which they live in. And this is what we do. We gather unorganized raw materials and we mold them, hammer them, and forge them into ideas. Automobiles, skyscrapers, computers, telephone systems, everything. It's very bad for the surface of the earth. It releases all these toxic byproducts. We have to go now very deep into the beneath the surface to bring up the heavy metals that we need. These heavy metal wastes are poisonous at the surface of the earth because atmospheric chemistry requires centuries to reduce that kind of stuff. Yet in space, all of these things go on much more easily. Space is like what you see when you close your eyes in a dark room. It's a place where ideas can be put. In space, matter behaves much more like thought. It's weightless. You can construct it in various ways that would be impossible on the surface of the planet.